and thank you for joining me. Today I'm going to show you how to make this fire surround. Now this is a really simple project, but will add a really nice detail to a room. Now this is actually for my own doll's house, and I'm going to be using this in the study, so I have designed it with a more contemporary feel in mind, but with a few slight alterations you could easily make this to fit in with a more period setting. Now I haven't included a cutting list with this one, because I'm going to tell you how to size it as we go along. So, let's get started. I'm going to begin by showing you how to work out the sizes for the pieces that you're going to need for the surround. Now I'm quite lucky that I haven't yet installed the chimney breast, so it's going to be easy for me to work on. But if you're working to a chimney breast that is installed in a room of your doll's house, you might find it easier just to get in there with your smaller 6-inch rule, measure the width and the height of the opening, and then measure the width of the overall surround. You can then transfer that onto a piece of graph paper and work from that. So we're going to begin by cutting pieces for the sides. So you want those to be, or to go from the ground and to stop 5 millimetres before the top, or before the top of the opening. And just as a guide, for my pieces I've cut them 88 millimetres high by 22 millimetres wide, and that's 3.5 inches by 7/8 of an inch. So you want two of that same size. Then we're going to cut a piece to go across the top like that. Now I've done it so that my side pieces overlap the sort of legs by about 5 millimetres, or 13/64 of an inch, and the same with the top piece, which is why we cut the side pieces 5 millimetres short of the opening. And then for width, I really just worked it out so that I had a nice border along each side. And again, as a guide, this piece is 115 millimetres wide by 27 millimetres high, and in inches that's 4.5 inches by 1 1/16. Now the height you can just work out what looks good really. I initially did this a little bit thinner, but it didn't look quite right. If you do your graph paper as I suggested, then you can sort of lay it out like this, do the height of your chimney breast as well on the paper, and then you can work out what looks good. But that sort of 27 millimetres, 1 1/16 of an inch, I think is a nice height to have above the opening of the fireplace. So that's those bits. And then I've just created some mouldings here. And what these do is they strengthen the piece. So they cover up this line across here, as well as being a decorative moulding. So that piece you'll want to cut again as wide as your side piece. So in my case, the 22 millimetres. And then just longer than the top piece, and I've got about 3 millimetres longer than this, so that we've got that little bit of an overhang to cover up the gap there between the two pieces. So that will sit there like that, and you can make them longer if you like. This is where your sort of designed flair will come into use. And again, that's why it's good to have that graph, because then you can sort of lay it all out like this and see what looks good and what doesn't. And just use scrap pieces of wood before you're sure how you want to do it. And again, on the decorative side, I've just done a couple of little mouldings at the bottom there. And again, they're that same width. And I've done those 27 millimetres high, which is again is the 7/8 of an inch. And these ones were 30 millimetres long. So again, the width of the top piece here, or the height as it is there, plus another 3 millimetres, or 1/8 of an inch. Just lay it out like that. And then what you can actually do, if you want to create some decorative mouldings along here, you can do that. I'm going to leave mine plain. I want it to look really quite simple, which I think suits the decor of the room. But if you wanted to do, you could do some little squares, or you might have a pre-made moulding made from plaster cast or something that you might want to use. You could do diamonds, maybe do 3 diamonds, a big one in the middle and a couple of smaller ones. And when I was doing my beach room project, I used balsa wood to make a little boat shape that I stuck in the middle there. If you want to make just a simple shape, a square or a diamond or something like that, then you could use 1.5mm, 1/16 of an inch thick sheet wood, which just makes it easier to cut than the 2.5. But if you wanted to do a more sort of intricate little shape like the boat, then you could use balsa wood. Balsa wood is really easy to cut, and once it's been painted and left for a while, it also hardens. So that would be ideal for this sort of project. And then for the mantelpiece, I'm going to do a double one, so it's got a little bit of a ridge on it. So I've cut two pieces, and the first piece out of the 2.5mm sheet wood again, which by the way I've used for all of these pieces, 2.5mm sheet wood, that's 3/32 of an inch. And for the little moulding I've used 0.8mm sheet wood, and that's 1/32 of an inch. So that piece, cut that piece first. If you're going to do a moulding, that's totally optional. You might just want to do the mantelpiece as one piece like that. I think this makes a nice little detail on it. And you want to cut that as wide as the surround, plus a millimetre at either side, or 1/32 of an inch at either side. And then this will be, again, so that it's just slightly longer than that first moulding. And I've done it 2mm longer, 5/64 of an inch at either side. Again, the depth of those is up to you. If you've got something in particular you want to place on the mantelpiece that maybe is quite deep, like a special clock or something like that, then obviously go by that. But I've just gone and measured the one out in our breakfast room and based it on that. And that makes this piece, trying to find where I wrote it down, 17mm deep, which is 11/16 of an inch. And then if you're doing the moulding, you just want to cut that a little bit narrower. It's probably again a millimetre or 2mm narrower than the mantelpiece, so that you've got that nice little ridge or little border around the edge there. And then finally, because I'm sort of copying a photograph of a really lovely fire surround that I found, I'm going to do a little surround on the inside there, which I'm going to be painting black. And you basically, again, you want to measure so that you've got a little bit of an overhang. So these bits will be 5mm shorter than your side piece, and I've done them at 10mm so that I can tuck 5mm behind and I'll have 5mm hanging out at the side there. And when we come to glue all this together, it'll make more sense, I'm sure. And then the top bit you want to fit just on the inside, so that will be as wide as the opening. If I move these pieces out of the way, so this is basically a little surround that will sit on the inside of the opening. So your first bit will be as wide as the opening, and then you'll just cut the legs to fit down to the bottom like that, and one on the other side as well, and we'll be fixing that into place at the back of the surround. So we've got that nice sort of lip around the inside there. I think that looks really nice, but again, that is optional. You don't have to do that bit if you want it a little bit more open. Okay, let's start fitting it all together. Once you've cut all of the required pieces, begin by sanding along each edge of each piece. So with your sandpaper flat on your work surface, just sweep the piece along it in one direction. And do that on each edge. And I've already done all of these pieces. And then sand the surface of each piece using a medium grade sandpaper and small circular motions. And that will prepare the piece nicely for paint or varnish. And once you've sanded them all, you can use a soft brush to remove the sanding dust. Okay, we're now going to begin construction. So I've got some glue here, which I've dispensed onto a piece of card, and I'm using a cocktail stick to apply it. And we're going to begin by attaching the side pieces to the bottom edge of the top piece. So apply a little bit of glue along the top of each side piece. Lay it flat on your work surface. Push the pieces together. And you can use a spare piece of strip wood just to make sure that you've got a nice flush edge along that left-hand side. So push both pieces against it. Like that, and then do the same on the other side. And then just go in to slide that piece across my desk. I don't want to pick it up in case it falls apart, but I just want to get that out of the way. That can be left to dry for a moment. And I then want to bevel one short edge of each of the mouldings. So again, with your sandpaper flat on your work surface, take the moulding, hold it at a 45 degree angle, and just sweep it towards you, keeping it at that angle. Just starting to bevel off there. So keep going until you've got a nice even bevel, and you can then finish that piece off with a piece of fine grade sandpaper just to smooth off those edges. So do that with each of those mouldings. The mouldings are now ready to glue into place. So apply glue to the back. And these are the longer ones, so the ones for the top. And again, just lay that along that edge so that it's flush with the edge and with the top. So get it into position, and then you can bring your piece of strip wood in and push everything up against it. Make sure you've got a nice flush top edge and a flush side. Use a spare cocktail stick to remove any excess glue. The other one. There's lots of ways of personalising these surrounds. I think if you saw the one I made for the kitchen, I put some grooves into the sides. That always looks quite nice. You could do that. Or just really by adding different mouldings. You can even apply sort of a second moulding to the moulding so that you've got a more sort of layered effect. If you're doing that, I'd probably use thinner wood for the mouldings so that it doesn't sort of look too chunky in areas. I'm going to attach the bottom ones, and on these I want the bevel side facing upwards or towards the top. I have them down on the top ones there. Like that. And then just take a piece of kitchen towel and lay it over the top of the piece, and I just want to weigh each of these ones down, so I'm going to use my glue. A pot of paint there. So that can now be left to dry. So whilst that's drying, I'm going to shape the mantelpiece, and I'm going to bevel one long edge and both short edges. So again, with the sandpaper flat on your work surface, hold it at a 45 degree angle, just picking the nicest side there to go upwards, and then just sweep it towards you, keeping it at that angle. So keep going until you've got a nice even bevel all the way along, and then you can do the same at each end. Thank you. And once again, just finish that piece off in your hand with a piece of fine grade paper. Because the moulding is cut from such a thin wood, the 0.8 millimetre, the 1/32 of an inch, we're just going to bevel this piece in our hand and support it as high up as you can with your finger, and then just sweep the sandpaper along at a 45 degree angle. And you're not going to get as sharp a bevel as you did on the thicker piece, but you just want to take off one edge on one side of the piece, just like that. And the same at the other end, and then you could do the same thing again along the long edge. So support the piece and just sweep the sandpaper along at a 45 degree angle. Like that. I'm then going to glue the moulded piece to the actual mantle so that we're just leaving a lip around the edge. So you just want it on the inside of the bevel of the thicker piece. So that fits perfectly at the sides. I've just got a little bit of extra overhanging at the back. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to glue it together and then I'll trim that off. So apply glue to the thinner piece. And then attach it to the mantle so that the bevel sides are on the same edge. Just want to leave a tiny little border on the flat edge of the wood. Like that. Press them together. Remove any excess glue. And then I'm going to clamp these together whilst the glue dries. Try and get a couple at each end. That way. And just fit on as many as you can all the way along. And that piece can also be left to dry. So once you've allowed enough time for the glue to dry, remove the clamps. And I've just sanded that again. Because I left it to dry overnight, the clamps have just made a few little indentations along the underside there, which you can just sand away. Now I just want to trim off that little overhanging bit at the back there. And you can either sand that away or you can use your craft knife. And I'm actually going to use my knife just to get a cleaner cut along there. I'm going to have to do it facing away from you because I can't do it left-handed. So, but I'm just pulling the knife along the back of the mantelpiece and just trimming away that overhang. Just so I've got a nice flush edge along the back there. I'll give that a bit of a sand as well. And this is now ready to be attached to the base part, which is also now completely dry, and that will just be attached along the top so we've got an even overhang at either side. So just apply the glue along the top of the sort of base part. And I just sanded the back of the mantelpiece as well, like that. Pop that back down flat on your work surface, and then you can just push the mantelpiece against it. Again, just so that you've got that even overhang at either side, and that will normally be the sort of width of your little beveled edges that will be overhanging. Press it together. Sort of pressing and holding. Because of the shape of this, we're not going to be able to clamp it or anything. But what I am going to do is just stand it on its top like that. And then just leave that to dry. Whilst that part's drying, I'm going to paint the inserts. So I've attached a piece of masking tape here, sticky side up, to a piece of card, and I'm just going to lay those on there, and that just makes them easier to paint. And again, I'm using the off black. Make sure you get along the sides of the piece of wood as well, so that there's no natural wood showing once these pieces are in place. Then once you've applied the paint, just lift that up so that it's not going to stick to the card. Once you've allowed enough time for the glue to dry, this piece is ready for paint or varnish. And again, I've secured some pieces of masking tape sticky side up to my painting card. I'm just going to lay that on there, and that just makes it easier to paint. And for mine, I'm just using an emulsion paint in pale cream. The fire surround has had two coats of paint, and I sanded gently after each coat had dried. The inserts are now also dry, so we're now going to attach those. So turn your fire surround over and draw a little line, 5 millimetres or 13/64 of an inch from the sort of inside edge, and do a little pencil mark at the bottom there, and do that on each side. 5 millimetres, 13/64 of an inch, and if you remember, that's what we measured for the overhang. And also do a little line closer to the top there. You can then actually apply the glue directly to the back of the surround. You want to go on the sort of inside edge of those pencil marks. And take the glue up to the top of the side piece there. Same over the other side. So you've got two shorter inserts and the one long one. So take one of the shorter ones, and so that the paint is facing down, attach it so that it's just to the right hand side of this first set of pencil marks. Get that into position, press it down. Make sure it's flush along that bottom edge. Just making sure I've got it lined up there. And then because we've applied the glue, I'm going to attach this one at the same time. So same thing again, and this time you want to put it just to the left of those pencil marks. Again, make sure it's flush along the bottom. Again, press that down, and then you can just turn the piece over and use another cocktail stick to remove any excess glue, and sort of press down on the leg as you do it. Come around that side. And then carefully turn over again, and then you can apply glue along the top, so a little bit above each of those shorter inserts, and then along that top, above the cutout there, above the opening. And this just really finishes it off, I think. And I really like the look of these when I see them in photographs and things. Again, painted side down, just lay that across the top of the two that are already there. Press that down, and then we can just turn over again. And quite a bit of excess glue there this time. So press it down, and get rid of that excess. And there is the completed fire surround. And I'm really pleased with how that's turned out, and I think that insert just really makes it as well. I really hope you've enjoyed this tutorial and that you'll give this one a go. And if you do, I'd really love to see your photographs and see any little adaptations you've made. And you can share photos over in my Facebook group, Little Bits and Pieces by You. And I'll pop a link to the group below. In the next episode of my Doll's House Diary, which will be episode 20, I'll be fitting this into place and applying the wallpaper to the chimney breast. So do look out for that episode. And for now, thank you for watching, and I'll see you again soon.